This conference will now be recorded.
Great. Thanks everyone for watching my earlier video on linear regression approach 2. I'm sorry, there was some technical issue while the recording session was going on. And I realized it the very next moment after uploading the video. The video went on mute for more than 35 to 40 minutes. So I have decided to redo the whole thing or do it again and upload. So that makes easy for everyone. Okay, so let's jumpstart into the agenda today without wasting any time. So what I was explaining you earlier was each developer approaches in a different way. Okay, the syntax of applying linear regression, the syntax of trying to gather or trying to establish the linear relationship, and the syntax of model of line will always be the same. The approach that varies depends on how smart the person is. For example, you may spend more time in pre-processing the data and you may spend very less time in applying the models. The other person may spend less time in pre-processing the data and more time on applying various models and trying to predict which one is the best. So today I'm going to show two different approaches where one person will split the data in one way and the other person splits the data in other way. As a data scientist, you must be aware of thought process. You must be aware of, and you must be in a very good thought process of approaching the solution for business in different ways. That's the agenda. Okay. For this thing today, what we are going to discuss is we are going to 1 minute. I'm trying to understand where that is, that slide. Okay, I think this is where it is. Yeah, today we are going to predict the, guys, just connect the dots. Earlier, first exercise was flight delay detection using Spark machine learning libraries. We have used Bucketizer, and we have used standard scalar, and we split the data, and we also used dimensionality detection, applied the linear regression and got the predictions. After that, we try to understand GDP per capita versus life satisfaction. There we have applied linear regression. Flight delay detection was done using random forest. Now we are going to implement to identify the miles per gallon of a car depending upon the artifacts of the car, means age, cylinder, and the horsepower, the manufacturer, and the country. Considering these scenarios, we are going to predict the miles per gallon. That's the requirement today. We'll be approaching in different way. The other videos approach and this approach will be a bit different, creating an awareness for you on April. You can approach the business problem different ways. Now, this is the linear regression formula. You know that beta of 0 is nothing but theta of 0. Beta of 1 is nothing but theta of 1. Beta of 0 can also be called as T1 or T0 to that matter. Shouldn't be a problem. And one thing I want to highlight here, because I was taking these notes from hands-on machine learning book, I couldn't hard code or I couldn't change the shape of this formula. Actually, the formula stands like this. I is equal to 1 from n. Okay, it's like y of 1 minus y of I whole square. Okay, this is not 2, and this I equal to 1 will be sitting underneath here. Okay, please be aware of that. 1 second. That's what it is. I'm making sure I'm not on mute and I don't want to waste my time and energy like the other day. So that's the thing. Please be aware of this formula. Perfect. I'll erase all the drawings. Now, what happens is, this is the same stage here. Okay. Y minus yi minus beta of 0, beta of 1 into x1, beta of 2 into x2. Okay. And beta p into xp. Okay. This is nothing but, 1 minute, let me show you that. Beta 0 of cap, beta 1 of cap, beta 2 of cap. That's what the formula is. Okay. So just to make sure, I'm telling you the things that are very important to understand and important to consider. Okay. So this is the formula. Guys, always remember the linear regression formula, what you're seeing here is always accomplished and is looking like that because of minimizing the residual sum of square equations. This is this RSS. RSS means residual sum of squares equation. We are going to discuss very clearly about this. Don't worry. One way of expressing that one is like this. And if you have many number of parameters, you can expect that you can expand that. This yi can be further expanded into excuse me, yi minus b theta. Okay. Likewise, you can also say I want my b1 into x1, b2 into x2, and bp into xp. That's the thing. Okay, please be aware of that. Always remember, your linear regression formula is looking like that based upon the results that are accomplished using root mean square error, or you can also call it as residual sum of squares. Always remember, residual sum of squares is one formula that is dependent, or linear regression formula is dependent on residual sum of squares. We are going to discuss that in detail. Pointed, perfect. Now we need to understand what is the difference between ordinal category variable versus dummy binary variable. Always remember, guys, the way how it works is you have an x-axis, you have a y-axis. Your x-axis will have 1 to 10, your y-axis will have 1 to 100. You need to plot, or you need to differentiate, or you need to come up with a formula of linear relationship between x and y. How can that be achieved? That can be achieved using numbers. But what happens if you have strings or names? For example, United Kingdom is country name. That's not a number. United States is a country name. That's not a number. India is a country name. That's not a number. If you have these two things as a part of your dependent variables, you will have to convert them into numbers. That is called dummy binary variable. The name itself explains what it is doing. Zeros and ones are binaries. Binary variable. Dummy binary variable means you are trying to create one dummy binary variable to reference that name. If you're talking about United Kingdom, 100 is United Kingdom. If you're talking about United States, that is 001. If you're talking about United States, that is 010. 100 is, for example, okay, I think I have confused you. Let me go back a bit. If it is, let me take a pen again. If it is 100, that is United States. Okay. If it is 110, that is United Kingdom. If it is 111, that is India. This is the simplest way how you can convert your categorical variable into dummy binary variable. I'm going to show that practically. Don't worry. So just understand the concept like that. Why are you doing it? You are doing it for the reason you wanted your machine learning process to be aware and not to confuse with the names, because the manufacturer country is one of the dependent variable for me to get the predictions. What am I going to predict? I'm going to predict miles per gallon. What are the artifacts given to me? Horsepower, cylinder, origin. If these are all things, I have to take these features and come up with the prediction. When one of the feature is having a name, which is not a number, I tend to confuse as a model, don't confuse me. So as a process of data pre-processing or as a process of data preparation to load into your algorithm or a model, you need to convert any other categorical variable you have into dummy binary variable. Perfect, we got that. One important thing I want to highlight here is, basically if you're working with R, as I told you, I will be covering as R as well. We will be completing the whole course using Python and R both. So don't worry about that. Basically what happens is, in Python, unlike R, there is no option to represent categorical data as factors. Okay, factors in R are stored as a vector of integer values and can be labeled. That's the one advantage R language has got. But Python has got no such advantage. For that reason, what are you doing is, you are simply saying, my dear Python, can you please help me in converting this categorical variables into dummy binary variables? As simple as such. Okay, now you may get me a doubt. Amar, that's fine. I understood the theory. How are you going to achieve that? Simple. If you have a series of data or you have a data frame, you can just convert those categories into numbers using pandas series. Pandas is PD, and PD has a function called AS type. AS type. AS type means I want to convert my categories into binary variables. I want to convert my binary variables into binary variables into categories. You can do either way. Just say as type. That is also will be covered practically. First, understand the concept of theory, and then we'll jump to practicals. Perfect. This is thing, guys. I'm repeating this. This session is already covered, but unfortunately, the video went on. The recording was on mute for more than half an hour, so that's the reason I am repeating it. Okay. So this slide is very clear. Let's quickly recap. Very simple, boss. All you have understood here is, what is your linear regression formula? What is the dependency of residual sum of errors with linear regression? And how you can accomplish the linear regression formula by minimizing the residual sum of squares? And what happens is, you understood what is your B theta, B1, and X are your features. Perfect. Let me go on next slide. Now, what happens is, we are also going to talk about coefficients and intercepts. When I say coefficients and intercepts, if you remember my last class where I have explained you about life satisfaction versus GDP per capita, I gave you some glimpse about intercepts and coefficients. But today I'm going to talk very practically on that one. We'll cover each and everything about it. Very simple. All you have to first theoretically understand about coefficients is, coefficients are nothing but they are having an array of tuples for each of the column. Here, think practically, you are going to predict miles per gallon. That is your prediction. What are your features? You have several features. You have cylinder as one feature. You have displacement as one feature, you have horsepower as one feature, you have weight as one feature. So you have x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, xn, x8, like that. Now, you need to know the coefficient of each factor, okay? And that coefficient must be linked with the every iteration it is doing. So that is the importance of coefficient. I'm going to explain it very clearly. Now, what happens is, coefficient can be achieved by one of the function, that is inbuilt function which Python has got. This is the formula. This is the function. If you just say print regression underscore model dot coefficient underscore, that will give you the coefficient value for that particular column. Super. I understand that. Now, you may ask me, what the hell? What is coefficient exactly? Coefficient is nothing but this is the function that shows an array of tuples with coefficient values present in that. Okay, I'm a fresher. I'm just passed out guy. I don't know what is an array. I don't know what is a tuple. Don't worry. Go back to my Spark sessions. I'll show you that. Give me 1 second, guys, because it's very, very important. If you don't understand what is array and if you don't understand what is tuples, you will tend to miss a lot of important information. Give me 1 minute. I'm going to stop my screen sharing for 1 second because I need to find out where I have that video, and then I'll start screen sharing. I'm not muting, don't worry. Because I know what happened last time when unintentionally or unknowingly I've muted it, and it messed up everything. Okay, go to my Hadoop ThoughtWorks channel. I'll sort by most popular. Okay, I'm sharing my screen now. Perfect. The screen is shared. Let me see if recording is going on and I'm not on mute. Superb. All is well. Now, all you need to do is, guys, to understand the basic concepts of what is a data frame, how the data frame works, you need to understand the Spark transformations implementation. This is part two. This is part one. And you also need to know about Spark deep dive, very, very important. And this is Spark two transformations again. Okay. And this is other Spark transformations. This is other Spark transformations. Okay. And this is Spark session 5. Go ahead and search. You'll get the subject of the video very clearly. And this is about Spark transformations implement part 1. This is about Spark performance tuning. And what else? Yeah, these are the most important things. And if you are completely new to Linux, please watch this video. This video will help you a lot. That's the longest video, 3 hours, 24 minutes, but I have covered very important basic concepts of how the Linux environment and Linux administration skills are important for big data and for machine learning as well. So these are the important things you need to know. I'm not saying this is must, but I'm saying it will help you a lot in learning things faster. I'm erasing all the drawings. I'm going back to my pointer. I'm closing this playlist because it leads the memory or network bandwidth. Perfect. So we were stopped at understanding the tuples and arrays. Basically, the function regression dot modal dot coefficient underscore is the one that stores the values of your coefficients of the feature. If we have 7 features, all the 7 features coefficient values will be stored in that function. Superb. Now, it contains an array of intercepts, that is beta of 0 values. Superb. Now, the linear modal formula after coefficients and intercept values are known will be derived like this. We'll talk about this practically. Let me highlight that one because that's very important for us. I'll explain this formula very practically in the next few minutes. Don't worry. Okay, now what happens is, one important thing you need to highlight here is, because we have not done any future scaling or dimensionality reduction in this session, we cannot say anything about the relative importance of each of our features given these coefficients, because the features are not of same scale. So we have not discussed about one of the important concepts called importance. Relative importance of the features. Relative importance of the features mean, when you are going to make a prediction, if you have been given 4 features, which of the 4 features is my top priority I can rely on so I can ignore other 3 features? If you have got that chance, you will pick one feature and go ahead. If the business requirement is such a case that you definitely have to depend on 2 features out of 4 features and you have to work 2 features. In that way, you need to first understand the relative importance of the features. It works based upon the dimensionality detection. If you remember the flight delay detection process, I have an origin column, I have a destination column. What did I do? I created a new column telling origin underscore destination with the concatenation function of Spark. Perfect. Now, what did I do in life satisfaction versus GDP? I have removed the columns which I don't need, and I also done a part of cleaning process before loading the model. So there is a big difference between data cleaning and dimensionality reduction. Dimensionality reduction means if we have been given 10 columns, is there any way where you can reduce that 10 columns into few number of columns, or is there any way where you can join two columns into one column and work on getting the best performance? That is called dimensional reduction process. So one point here you should be aware of is we have not discussed yet about the relative importance of each features. I'm talking about this point. We'll discuss about this bit later because we have not come to that point yet, but this is one of the important concept you must be aware when you are pre-processing your data. That's done. Now, this is the formula of residual sum of errors, and this formula, let me take a pen again. This formula can further be expanded. Okay. Why pen is not working? Oh, yeah. This formula can further be expanded into this process where your y of I minus beta of 0 minus beta of 1 into x1, where y is your prediction and x is your features. If you have been given x1 as one feature, x2 as one feature, means x1 is x1 can be weight, x2 can be cylinder, x3 can be horsepower, like that. So this is residual sum of errors formula. This is the short form and this is the full form. And under the linear regression, 1 second guys, give me 1 minute. I'm back, guys. I have unmuted. Okay, don't worry. There was something I need to take a call, so I went and unmute. Perfect. So, underlying formula of linear regression is looking like this because under the hood, this is what happening. So, if somebody asks you about linear regression, tell them, boss, I have very crystal clear clarity what and how things works under the hood. Beta of zero is my parameters. Beta of zero can be attained by the way I minimize the residual sum of errors. Residual sum of errors is also one formula. Okay. While I train the model, I work on the coefficients process. That coefficient process is being done by a function called regression underscore model underscore coefficient, and that coefficient is the one holding the beta zero values. Now you can also say the coefficient values and intercepts are dependent on each other, whereas a coefficient is a tuples of coefficient values and regression model dot intercept contains the array of intercept values. That is the difference. Array, the simple guys, I differentiate that. The intercept will have array of intercept values. Intercepts will have array of intercept values, and coefficients will have tuples of coefficients. Understand the difference? Coefficients will have values in the form of tuples. Intercepts will have values in the form of arrays. As simple as such. Okay, cool. Let me remove the drawings here. And let me take a pen pointer again. Now, this slide is very clear, so we don't need to recap anything here. Okay, let's go to next one, scoring the model. Now, scoring the model means I have not done any scoring when I did it on life satisfaction versus GDP per capita. But here I'm doing it. Why? Because earlier my approach was different. Here my approach was different. There I need not have to check the scores of my country. I have picked one country and I wanted to check if that country has got, if that country money is making people happy. That's yes or no. That's it. Yes or no. And how much percentage is that? And I compare the percentage. But here that's not, here the case is different. Here the case is different because I have been given many cars. If I pick one car, I wanted to know how much this car is giving the mileage or miles per gallon prediction. And I also wanted accuracy. And I also wanted to know the base value, what I got, and how better is my regression model giving me the predictions at the score value. That's what I'm saying. Okay. And one more thing you have to be aware is, this is the common method of measuring the accuracy for regression models. If someone asks you, okay, I'm happy that you know linear regression, I'm happy you know about intercepts and coefficients, and if they ask you, have you worked on scoring, tell them, yes boss, I worked on scoring. For me, in my linear regression model, the scoring is nothing but that's the common method of measuring the accuracy. If they ask you the formula, yes, I know. Okay, if they ask you, do you know the formula, just tell them, boss, yes, I know the formula. Formula is nothing but R square equal to 1 minus RSS by TSS. RSS is residual sum of squares. I explained you very clearly how that works. Super. And now here, this residual sum of squares is the one that measures the variability left unexplained after performing the regression. Means, for example, if you are expecting a value 1, but if you have got a value 2, there is a variability between 1 and 2, right? This residual sum of squares is the one that measures the variability of 1 and 2. And it tries to give you an explanation why there is a difference between 1 and 2. Okay, that is called RSS. Okay, now let's understand what is TSS. TSS is nothing but TSS measures the total variance in Y. Okay, what is Y? Y is your predictions in Y axis. So residual sum of squares is not working on X. Residual sum of squares is working on the variability that's unexplained. So try to understand the difference here. I'll make it more clear. Simple guys, the TSS works on Y-axis and RSS works on the variability left unexplained after performing the regression. Means it's talking about the total value that comes out of your model. Super. Now, what happens is the R square statistics is the one that is measuring the proportion of variability in Y that is explained by using X for our model. Okay, let's establish a link now between RSS, TSS, and R square. RSS is, it's coming with a definition of explaining the variability between 1 and 2. As I told you, one, I expected 1, but I got 2. That's explaining it. Now, TSS is, it is working on the total variance it got in Y. Superb. And RSS is different, TSS is different. And R square is the total formula of my squaring, which says of scoring. R square equal to 1 minus RSS by TSS. So R square is nothing but, that is the statistical measurement of the total probability that is explained in Y using X as a difference. So this will tell you, okay, this is the proportion of variability from Y depending upon the reference you have taken with X. That's the smartness of it. Perfect. Now we understood very well about the scores also, and we are happy. Perfect. Let me raise the drawings now. Okay. Now, R2 can also be determined using our test set and model score method. Very good. We understood this slide perfectly well. Let's move on to the next slide. Okay. Mean square error. Mean square error is nothing but What you can make a prediction is like your residual square of, what did I say? RSS is your residual sum of squares. Perfect. Now, like RSS, you have mean square error. This mean square error will try to compare the predictions for the test data set with the ground truth. If the ground, for example, as per the market statistics, if an average car has to give 26 mileage per gallon, that is my ground factor. So this mean square error uses scikit-learn, and it compared the predictions that is given by model with the ground statistics. What are the ground statistics? For example, let's say it is 28. If you say 28 as a base truth, it will come up with a process and compare the predictions of your test data with that one. That is the mean square error. Okay. Now we understood theory about how we are going to approach it. We discussed about coefficients. We discussed about intercepts. We discussed about scoring process. We discussed about RSS. We discussed about TSS. We discussed about R square. Super. Let's go ahead and do the practicals right now. As I told you, in the practicals, I have taken two different approaches. The first approach is one developer think in one direction and other developer think in other direction. Okay, let me show you that. Okay, this has already been done. I have not made any changes. I have not done anything. It is the same process, but try to understand the difference. Okay, this Untitled 2 is one developer, Untitled 3 is other developer, and Untitled 4 is nothing but I'm going to show you how this categorical variable works. Okay, first one, Untitled 2. As a basic need, you always import package for your functions to work, or your functionality, or to solve the business use case, you need Python packages. For that purpose, I am importing pandas as PD. Perfect. Again, my data set is sitting in users, my name in downloads. I have this one, auto mpg.csv. Perfect. Still here it is clear. Now I have loaded this data into a variable called data frame. Superb. If you go and one second guys, I'll show you that. I'm passing the screen sharing for 1 minute. Bear with me. Okay, I'm sharing my screen now. If you see here, this is all very, very properly explained, but the problem is this is on mute. Do you see here the video is playing here? Let me show you.
It makes a
till this point it's clear.
Which we discussed
here.
Give me
from here it went on mute. Okay. If you see the practicals of it, still I have done everything from scratch, activating my virtual environment. And after that, I imported the package and I have also done loading the data set as data frame. After that, I have also did print df.head. I have not copy pasted any of the commands, so you can go ahead and have a look. This recording was muted till 45th minute, I believe.
I have not stored
till this point.
Let me tell you what.
Till this point, it was not okay. There was one mistake that was done. I recovered that, and I'll show you that one also. So the reason why I showed this video right now for you is I have written the commands properly over here. If you wanted to have a look at those commands, please come back and watch this video. The video name is Linear Regression Approach to Each Developer Thinks Different. I'm not going to delete it, but I'm gonna make it as duplicate. Okay, you will have a tail name called duplicate here. Okay, let's go back. Now, first I have downloaded my data set and I have loaded my data set into a variable name called data frame. Perfect. Understand that. After that, what I have done is I have done print data frame dot head. So this is going to show me how my data set is looking like. I have MPG as one column, cylinders as one column, displacement as one column, horsepower as one column, weight as one column, acceleration as one column. So these are all columns. Now, basically what happens is for my requirement, I don't need a car name as part of my features. Okay, this is the index. This is the column. This is the name of the column. For that purpose, I said, take a variable called data frame, and that data frame will have results stored in the data frame, and drop the car name access equal to one. When I say access equal to one, it should be a column. When I say access equal to row, access equal to zero, that is a row. Okay. So it is now removing the name column. It is now removing the column car name. Perfect. Here comes the categorical variable into dummy binary variable. Okay, guys, try to understand something. You have origin, right? You have origin 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. What does it mean? It is in a binary format, zeros or ones. But how can a machine know that 1, 0, 0 is America, 0, once again, 1, 0, 0 is America, 1, 1, 0 is Asia, and 1, 1, 1 is, for example, I'm saying, how can it know that? You have to tell, dear machine learning process, don't worry, I have converted this dummy binary variables and established a relationship between categorical variables and dummy binary variables. You have to understand that. How that can be achieved is what I have explained here. If you see here, very simple. I have imported pandas as PD, superb. And likewise, I said my data frame name is equal to DF shortcut. And using pandas PD, I said, go ahead and use the functionality called data frame. And for that data frame, I'm giving a name called vertebrates. That's the column name. And that column name, okay, that column name vertebrates will have bird, fish, amphibian, reptile, mammal. These are the columns. Okay, now these columns need to be converted into dummy binary variables. How can I do that? Very simple. Go ahead and check here. Go to your data frames and tell your data frames that your column name is vertebrates. And convert that column into categories. So you're using a function called as type. Very simple. You're using a function called as type, and you're converting that into categories, and just get the codes of that categories. So let me run that now. Perfect. Now let me show you. So I have got, now if I run this one, I got four columns, right? Let me add one more column. I'll say donkey. Not now. First, let's run this one and then I'll show you the results. Now, if I say, go ahead and use this as type function and convert the categories into cat codes. It has done it. Okay. Now, basically, what it's telling is 1, 2, 3. What is 1, 2, 3? Bird is 1. 1 second. There is a spelling mistake here. I need to use comma. Because if you see here, bird and mammal came as one string, but they are not one string. They are two different strings. Okay. Now, let me run this one. Now, if I run this again, okay, you got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 columns, right? Now, cat quotes. See, you see here, your bird is 1. Your mammal is 3. See, bird. 1, 1. Mammal, 3. Fish, 2. Amphibian, 0. Reptile, 4. Mammal, 3. You have mammal here, you have mammal here. So 3 here, 3 here. Now let me add one more thing. I'll say donkey. No, donkey is not a reptile. Seahorse, I say. Okay, and I say prawns, for example. Let's say. Okay. Now let me see what happens. Why is it only showing only 4? One minute, guys. Let me check. Okay, I think I have not run this yet. Let me run this one. Just say shift enter and now say shift enter. Okay, it's still showing this one. But now let me quickly have a look on this one. Now it is changed. Do you see that? Okay, now let me again try running all the cells. So I'm still not clear why this is not showing rest of the values. It is only showing this one. If I say df dot shape, let's see what it says. It says 9 rows and 1 column. That is fine. Now it should show me 9 rows, right? But it's showing only bird, mammal, fish, amphibian. Okay, that's fine. I'll sort this out later. Don't worry about it. But however, if you see here, at the end, it has, however, taken care of my request. So bird is given. Let me take a pen here. Bird is given 1 and 1. Mammal is given 3 and 3. Seahorse is given 6. Prawns is given 5. Fish is given 2. Amphibian is given 0. Reptile is given 4. So it has done the job it is supposed to do. Superb. This is the important thing you need to understand. What is the importance of converting categorical variables into dummy binary variables? Okay, superb. Now let's go back to our work. Here I have did the same thing. What did I do? I converted I have converted America into 1, Europe into 2, and Asia into 3. What did I do? I said, go ahead and take my data frame. My data frame is nothing but rows and columns, but in that, take the column origin. Okay, now this one I am initiating in one of the variable name. This is that variable name, and I'm using a replace function, and that in replace function I'm saying replace one with America, two with Europe, three with Asia. Okay, now go to next line. Understand next line. So for the same data frame variable, you are using a new function called get dummies. Okay, get dummies mean your machine learning model will understand, okay, this guy, for my understanding and my for my easy journey, he converted this origin into dummies. That is called dummy binary variable. Okay, like that. Let me erase all the drawings. Okay, like that. What happened now is your origin is converted into this bit. Okay, with this one, 100, if America, if it's one, it's America. If it's Asia, it's zero. At that time, you will have either one here, one here, one here. Just remember it that way, as I shown you earlier. So don't worry. Okay, very good. Let me erase all the drawings. Let me go back to pointer. I have been telling you guys, if you have any as part of your data pre-processing or as a part of your preparing your data for machine learning, you should make sure you don't have any question marks in your data, right? Did I explain you that? I told you very well, right? So that applies here also. You need to carefully check if your data is having any missing data or any question marks. Okay, so for that purpose, what I have done is I have used a functionality called check the question mark. Okay, that is the important concept you must be very much aware before you jump into your machine learning models. Once again, guys, I repeat, please be aware of it. Please make sure you do all the necessary preparation before loading your data into machine learning models. For that one, I checked if you have any question mark, replace that with np.nan. np.nan means NAN in NumPy means not available. If you have any such not available, please drop that columns. Perfect. This guy has approached it this way. Now let me show this guy is one developer, and there's other developer who does this work in a different way. Let's see that one also. Okay, now I'm going to here. Okay, what happens is this guy has loaded panda as PD, superb. This guy has given a data frame name df equal to lead.csv, superb. And this guy has checked the head, index, columns. What did this guy do? He didn't do all those things. He just said df.head. This guy said, show me the head, show me the index, show me the columns of what? Of your data frame. What is your data frame? Your data frame is nothing but a variable name which stores the values of all your data. Super. So these are my column names. My index starts from 0 and stops at 398. Means I have total 398 rows. Okay. And index of the column is MPG, cylinders, displacement, horsepower, weight, acceleration, model, origin, car name. This is object. Superb. Now he checked shape. When I say shape, it means I have 398 rows and 9 columns. Okay, now go back and check what this guy has done. This guy has first asked, go and find if we have any question marks or not. He has not checked whether he has question marks or not. This guy is smart. He knows, as part of my pre-processing step, I have to remove the question marks and I have to remove any NA. NA means not available. NA means duplicate. NA means missing data. There is always a possibility where you will have at least one. You'll have one missing data in your rows or columns. For that one, he directly approached it. But if you see here, this guy carefully first did in my data frame, if we have any null, can you please show me? So he said data frame, he used function called is null and just if you have any, show me here. So there is no nulls. Super. This guy went ahead again, checked what are the data types for my data frame. So this guy understood data frame is all looks good, but I got a doubt. Everything is float 64, int 64, float 64, all good. But what happened to horsepower? This is object. This is sensing something is wrong with this one. Okay. When I got something is wrong with this one, that guy first tries to see what are the values that are present in this one. Okay. To check that, what he's doing is he has used one command, which is called go to my data frame. In the data frame, I have a column called horsepower. And can you give me all the unique values in that? Okay. So what it does is in the 398 rows you have, it will try to pull all the unique values. Okay. Do you find anything suspicious here? Yes, I find something suspicious. What is that? You should be very careful with watching this one. Do you see this question mark? This is the most dangerous part. I have to remove this. Okay. Why? You shouldn't have any such things in your data. If you have any such things in your data, that will create unnecessary mess. So I need to remove this. How can I remove this? Now, try to understand the difference. That developer has simply assumed if I have any unnecessary question marks, go ahead and remove the question marks. And also, if I have anything related to NA or NAN, drop those columns. Superb. So what this guy has done, he first checked with unique columns. He understood that there is some question mark. So what he said is, now take a new variable or existing variable with name data frame. That data frame should have horsepower column values not equal to question mark. Okay. He has done this successfully. And after running it, he checked if the question mark is still existing in the horsepower column of your data frame. Okay, perfect. Now observe something here. You have 398 rows and 9 columns here. After removing the duplicates, you got 392 rows and 9 columns. What does it mean? 398 minus 392. You have 6 rows that have been removed, which are having duplicates and question marks. Now, he went back and checked. Again, here he's telling he's getting horsepower as object. He's sensing something wrong. So he has to change this object data type into something else. So what did he do again? He's smart enough. He converted it with a function called as type. So this object is now converted into float using a function called as type. Superb. This is also nice. Very good. He's doing a smart work. After that, he verified it. In verification, he said, yes, my horsepower is also converted to float 64. Awesome. After that, he tried to describe it. In the description, he got the count, mean, standard deviation, minimum 25%, 50%, 75% maximum. This is always very important for you to come to a guess estimation of how your data is going to look like. Perfect. This is the different approaches each developer would take while preparing the data for your linear regression, or to that matter, any data science algorithm or machine learning model. Superb. Let's go back to the work. Okay. Now, till here, we are clear, and we opened a new Jupyter notebook and tried to show how a different developer would think and achieve the target there. Superb. Now, what I'm doing is, let me take a pen. This is my This is my x-axis. Sorry, this is my y-axis. This is my x-axis. Okay. So what are you going to find? You are going to find your miles per gallon. Okay. Always remember your predictions, your labels and your features will be on x-axis. Your predictions will be on y-axis, right? So this y-axis will have my miles per gallon. Okay, that's my y-axis. Now, what will my x-axis have? My x-axis will have cylinders. My x-axis will have displacement. My x-axis will have comma, horsepower. my x-axis, one second guys, horsepower, my x-axis will have weight, my x-axis will have acceleration, my x-axis will have blah 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 blah. So when I know this is my x-axis, when I know this is my y-axis, I have to make necessary arrangements for that, so data is organized, sliced and diced in that way. I'm dropping all the drawings now. Let me go back to pointer again. For that reason, what I'm doing is, for my x, I'm dropping MPG. When I say axis equal to 1, that is rho. Okay, but my y is MPG. Always remember, guys, simple one line. Your x will have everything except MPG, which is miles per gallon, which is going to be your prediction. And your y-axis will have only MPG. Okay, so this x has stored the values. If I run this x, I got the values. Do you see MPG here? No, right? You don't have MPG because MPG has been removed. Now, if I go to y and if I run y, I'll get only MPGs, that is miles per gallon. Super, I got that. I understood very well. Now, if you just go back and watch my earlier recording, or if you have gone through it, I have taken different approach. I have put keep indices. I have kept remove indices. Keep indices, I have taken 32 rows minus 7 rows is my keep indices. Remove indices is my 7 rows. So I have considered my 7 indices as sample data and 32 minus 7 as my test data. I have run on test data, I have showed you. I have run on my sample data, I have showed you. That's the different approach I have taken there. Here, what I'm going to do is, I am going to import a function called train test split. That is nothing but, in Scikit-learn, you have a function called model underscore selection. Okay, in that one, you need to import this package. Okay, for that package, the parameter or the command or skeleton of that command should look like your x-axis training data, your x-axis test data, your y-axis training data, your y-axis test data is equal to training underscore test underscore split functionality. Okay, for that one, x-axis, y-axis, test size equal to 0.25 means you have 392 rows, right? In that 392 rows, 0.25, 25% of your 392 will be your test data, and the random state equal to 1 means rows. Super. And then what did I do? I just said, go ahead and import the linear regression model, and my linear regression model should be implemented, and the results must be stored in the variable name called regression underscore model. Let's quickly do a recap. Very simple, guys. All you have done is you have split your data into training set and test set. And after splitting your data in training set and test set, you have started applying your linear regression. And when you apply your linear regression, your linear regression results are stored in a variable name called regression underscore model. Okay. Always remember, when you have trained a model, that model should run on your data. On which data here? On your training data. How is your training data being arranged in x-axis and y-axis? So how do you say that? You say, my dear regression model, okay, go and fit that into your x-train and y-train. Means I have split my data into test set and training set. So in the training set, x-axis and y-axis, go and implement that. Perfect. Now if you see here, linear regression is implemented. Copy of x is true. It has taken a backup of that. It has fit the intercept equal to true. You need to understand what the intercept is. Number of jobs equal to 1. Normal is equal to false. Amazing. Superb. Now let's understand what's coefficients is. Very simple, guys. This is a Python function. I use for loop. I said for IDX means for this columns, take the column name first. In that, I have an x underscore train. What is x underscore train? Your x underscore train is nothing but this bit one, this bit, which is nothing but you have 392 rows. In the 392 rows, 25% is x. In that one, pick the columns. Okay, pick the columns. And for those columns, kindly give me the coefficients. And what is the formula for that? The formula is simple. Regression dot model underscore coefficient underscore. One second, guys. I did something wrong here. Control C. Okay, yeah. So this is the formula you're applying. After that, before that, I'm just applying the syntax for a for loop. So go and get me the coefficients for all the columns. Okay. Now, if you see here, let me run that one. Let me run all first. Cell run all. I want to show the values for you. Actually, we should get the coefficient value here. Let me quickly run all everything once again. I think it is not run. None. Perfect. Perfect. Again. Perfect. Again here. Run perfect. Again here. Perfect. Drop if you have any numpy with question marks. Perfect. Define your x-axis and y-axis perfect. I don't want to run x and y because I know what the values are. I'll jump into next sentence. And I'm splitting my training data and test data. Perfect. And after that, I'm applying the linear regression. Perfect. I'm going to fit my linear regression. Perfect. And now I'm going to run my coefficient values, which should give me the coefficients. Okay. Now, I'm not sure why it is not. Let me see if it is gives the intercept here. Yeah, intercept. See the way how I got my coefficients, I also should get my what we call the coefficient values also. Let me quickly check if I have made any grammatic or spelling mistakes in getting the coefficients. Give me 1 minute. Let me run this again if I need. Okay, for IDX, column name. I'll do this once again. For IDX, and you have a syntax called column name. You need enumerate process. For IDX, column name. If I do tab, it is going a different direction. It's taking space. So let me not use tab for now. Column underscore name in enumerate in. That's the spelling. It's called EN. Yeah, sometimes you know I go mad on spellings. Okay, now where are you applying it? You're applying it on training data x-axis. Sorry guys, I should have not done the tab again. So on your training data, perfect. In your training data you have columns, so go and get, no, not tab again. Let me not do tab. I'm doing it as part of practice. So x-train dot columns, perfect. With this one, you are going to do a for that one and apply it on all the columns. Super. Now if I say, give me 1 second, something is wrong actually. Okay, now I say print. I'm printing the coefficient. For the column, store the values of the column here, and the values should also be stored in here. Close this one, and you are telling the format will look like your column name is one format, is your one parameter in the format, and you say regression model, give me 1 second, regression model, and you can use coefficients as part of it, coefficients underscore, and you want to find for the columns, that is zero, and always use the loop which you have started, which is IDX. Okay, close the bracket. Now let me see this one. I'm not sure why it's not showing up, but it has to show. Okay, let me do something. I want to show you that one. 1 second, guys, give me 1 minute. Okay, sorry guys, I'm back. Let me open a new notebook. I wanted to tell you what the problem is. The problem here is the Jupyter notebook interpreter is not taking because we have already run that one. Okay, let me copy paste everything and I'll show you what I'm trying to do. Import pandas as PD. This is my new notebook. This is my new notebook. First bit. Second bit, sorry. Okay, I don't need this one. I need this one because I'm not validating it because I know the results look like. Third one is this one. And fourth one will be this one. Till here, let me run now. Okay, perfect, completed. Now I'll replace if I have any question marks and any missing data. NaN is used to delete the missing data. That's completed. Now my x-axis will have all the features. My y-axis will have only my MPG, which is miles per gallon. I have defined it. I'm going to split my training data and test data. Okay, let me do that. Okay, shift enter, completed. I move on to the next one. I'm now importing my linear regression process. I'm trying to train the model, and after training the model, implementing the linear regression model to fit for my training data and test data. Let me try this one. Shift enter. It has completed. Now here I need to say for ID X, and I have column name, and I'm using a I'm using enumeration. So enumerate means repeat. Okay, if you see, do you see the colors are changing? Do you see the for came into green color, enumerate came into green color? Let me show you something. And I'm running this on my training data. Pick it for all the columns. Okay, and here it's a function. Perfect. If you see here, this is you're starting a function, and once you start a function, this is indentation. The next command starts from this point. Now go back here. What happened? It didn't run here. And do you see for is not changed? If you see here, from is in green color, like that for should also be in green color, which means the indentation or the formatting of the command or query of your Python was messed up. That's the reason why it didn't give you the results. So always be aware of it. Your query will be correct, but your interpreter, your user interface, which is converting your code into understandable format for Python, is having a problem. So in that case, close everything and open a new thread and write it again. So now I'm going to print. What am I going to print? I'm going to print the coefficients. What coefficients I'm going to print? I'm going to print the coefficients of all the features. How many features I have? All the features, I have to store the values in this one. So the coefficients for that column is this value, right? That's done. So what is the format you are saying? I have format name as column name, super. And again, I use my regression model coefficient, which is called regression model under dot coefficient. Okay, now coefficient underscore. For what are you applying your coefficients for? You're applying the coefficients for your rows, not for columns. So say zero, and make sure you don't forget to loop in the IDX where you started. Now if I run this one, I get it perfectly. I'm super confident about that. Shift and enter. See, I got it. I have run the same query here, right? Why did it show me? That's the interpreter problem. Perfect. Now we got the coefficients. Okay. Now let me go here. Let me go to intercepts. The formula for intercept is very simple. It says boss regression dot model underscore intercept, and also print the intercept. Perfect. Now if I run it here, I'll get the value. Okay. Shift enter. You got the intercept as minus 19. This is what I was trying to explain you when I was explaining the GDP versus life satisfaction. But later on, I realized I should make another session for it. That is the reason today I'm making it this one for you, the different approach. Now, we got the intercept also. Now, let's establish a link between this one and the prediction models. Okay. So you're going to score it, right? What is the score? Score is very simple. For your regression dot model, which is nothing but your data, your value is stored here. For this one, you're asking to score X test and Y test. Just copy this one and just paste it here and just run it. You got 82. What does this mean? Carefully understand. Carefully understand. This means your model is having 82.85 of the variability in Y. That can be explained using X. Means whatever features you have in x-axis, like your cylinder, displacement, horsepower, your prediction is 82.85% variable, which is okay. Now we need to understand and deviate or remove any errors if you have. For that, I'm implementing root mean square error process. Okay, very simple. Understand the first line, like the way you import the package, just import your mean square error package, and you have your Y predictions. For that Y predictions, go ahead and predict for your X test. Very simple. Your Y axis is predictions. We all know that. So I'm just saying Y underscore predict will be the regression model prediction, which is applying your predict predict function on top of xtest. Okay, now what I'm saying is apply the mean square error functionality with the function mean square error on y predict and y test. Okay, very simple, do not confuse. Your mean square error is nothing but if you go back when I explained you about mean square error, mean square error functionality will reduce the difference what you have between the two sources, or it can also accomplish in removing the variations. That's what we are trying to do. So for that reason, we need to understand the syntax, the parameters, and the way how your mean square error works. Again, go back to you, understand your RSS, your TSS. RSS is the variability that is left unexplained. Y-axis is the total variance in Y. And R square is the probability variability of X of Y using X as reference. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to, very simple, I'll explain this again. Your Y prediction is nothing but you are applying your regression model's prediction on X test. Very good. Now, your X test prediction values are stored in a variable called Y predict. Perfect. Now, what happens is you are applying the root mean square error of your Y predictions and Y test data, and you are asking to give that values here, which means it's 12. So this output tells that root mean square error or mean square error has given you a value of 12, right? Now, don't you think I have to apply the square of it? I have to apply the square of it, right? For that purpose, I have imported math function. Let me do one thing which explains things more better for you. Okay. Now, one second, guys. This is my interceptor value. Okay. This is the coefficient value. Okay. Let me go to my PPT now. I need to erase all the drawings and I need to go to pointer. This is the magic. Okay. Take the pen. Okay. Interceptor is minus 19, right? Interceptor is minus 19. Okay. What is your coefficient for cylinder? 0.246. As 6 is greater than 5, I'll say 0.25. So my interceptor value plus the coefficient value into x1. Super. X1 is what? My feature. That is value of cylinder. Value of cylinder is different. Coefficient is different. Please be aware of it. And then 0.02. What is this 0.02? 0.02 is this one. The next coefficient. Okay. Into x2. Makes sense. This is x2. Makes sense. Now, minus 0.01. Why? This 6 is greater than 5. So I categorize this as 0.01. So 0.01 into x3. Superb. So what is next one? 0.073. Do you see this? 0.73. What happens? 1 minute, guys. Yeah. So the 0.7 is greater than 5. So this becomes 0.01. You always remember is minus 0.01. Okay. Now, minus 0.01 into x4. Perfect. Like that, you have, let me erase all the drawings now. Now you have 0.21, right? So 0.21, where is 0.21? 1 second. 0.218. 218 means 0.22. So 0.22 into x5. Okay. Like that, 0.78 into x5, 0 minus 1.77 into x6, 0.81 into x7, and 0.752 into x8. So that is the mathematical representation of your coefficients and intercepts to get a formula of linear regression. You understood that very well. Okay, with this one, till this point, one second, pointer, erase all drawings. With this point, you implemented, right? Now let me run this one. I've implemented my regression model on x-test and y-test. Superb. Now I'm going to apply the mean square error. Okay. Always remember, first thing, I'm not applying the mean square error directly. I'm only applying mean square error, and on that, I'll apply the square. So let me run this one. It says 12. Now I need to, what I need to do, I need to apply a square of that, square root of that. So simple function, go and import math, and in that math you say math dot square root of function. And how does that look? It says regression model underscore mean square error. Okay, if you've done it here, it says 3.49, which means, very careful, understand, the average of 3.50, you are away from the ground truth. Ground truth may be 25 gallons, but your prediction is saying 28 gallons. Okay, that is the average. So always remember, this is the way you can understand how far is your predictions close to the real one. Now, let's make a prediction, and I'll give some random values and ask it to predict. So I'll say, let me copy and paste it, man. Let's not waste time, because I explained this already in the last slide. So here what I'm saying is, I'm giving cylinder 4, I'm giving displacement 121, I'm giving horsepower 110, I'm giving weight as 2800, I'm giving acceleration as 15.4, I'm giving year as 81, I'm giving origin as Asia. Origin as Asia is 010. Okay, if it is United States, it's going to be 100. You know that, right? So I'll copy this one and I'll run this one here. So when I run this one, what happens is I got array 28.67. So which means, whichever the car is having these features will give the 28.7 miles per gallon. You can also find which car is that if you query the data from your data set. Okay, that is what it is. With this one, you have clearly understood how each developer works in a different way of cleaning the data or pre-processing the data. Earlier, we did remove indices, keep indices process to prepare the training set and test set. Here, we have directly used a functionality called train test split. We understood very properly about the coefficients, intercepts, root mean square error, predictions, scores, and the formulas of linear regression, and the under the hood, how this residual sum of square will work. With this session, I have completed the linear regression theoretically, practically, and under the hood architecture level also we have completed. So next session, I'll explain you the core basics of linear algebra, metrics, 2D, 3D, plotting, NumPy. I'm sure that is a very awesome video everyone will love, and you will love to gain more knowledge on machine learning, because next session will be your foundation stone and the fundamentals of mathematical formulas that are involved in the formulas where Python and R will interpret directly or indirectly for you. So hope you're all enjoying my videos. Please, if you like it, please click on like button. And if you don't like it, feel free. And I always welcome constructive criticism where I can improve myself, and it in turn helps many of the viewers who are watching the videos online spending time to learn and invest in their future. So if you're commenting, if you're liking, you are in turn helping many others like me and like you. So please free to like, comment, dislike, provide your valuable feedback. I will take your feedback and make sure those constructive feedbacks are implemented in the next session. Thank you so much for your time. It was nice presentation. It was nice video. It's just I had to do a rework because of the mute for a couple of minutes. See you in the next session. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Thanks a lot.